Asian markets traded little changed, even as data showed China's industrial output bounced back more than expected in April. It rose 3.9% year-on-year, marking the first expansion in the metric for this year. Well, as for Philippine shares, the PSEi index underperformed, falling by nearly 2%, ending the session and the week at 55.41. Joining us this afternoon for Investment Talk, AB Capital's Lexter Azurin. Hi, Lex. Thanks for joining us.
Hi, good afternoon, Mimi.
Good afternoon. So let's start with recovery scenarios. Morgan Stanley came out with research that actually plotted the sequence of Asia's economic recovery. China, of course, first in and assumingly first out, is going to start recovery by the third quarter of this year, while those who are most export-oriented economies like Thailand, Malaysia, and Singapore are grouped together under category four. They will be the last. They will likely take until first quarter of next year to start showing signs of relief. The Philippines, well, as you can see, we're in group number two, together with India and Indonesia. Do you think that this is what the market is pricing in?
Yes, hi, Mimi. Yeah, but well, by the looks of it, it might be in a different order. As you know, countries such as Korea, Taiwan, Thailand, Vietnam, and even Hong Kong have, as they call it, flattened the curve. So they're probably those countries that are probably ahead of the game. Daily cases are still rising in the Philippines, and if we don't see it further improve, further, then the recovery might be delayed for the Philippines. I guess for the market, it's taking it day by day. It's pricing in already a recession. But I think anything deeper than the 3.4% estimate of the government of the economy, the virus most likely will depress the market further. So I think it really depends. The recovery will really depend on how fast we can resolve this crisis. Mm-hmm. So I think for now we're looking at a U-shaped recovery for the market.
Mm-hmm. U-shaped recovery. I want to direct your attention to outsourcing, the BPOs, because that's a very big driver of the economy. Let's look at it from a different angle. I mean, when you've got the two biggest players, that is India and the Philippines, placed under what analysts describe as the strictest lockdowns, this sort of chokes up companies depending on us, right? I mean, do you think this will drive away clients and potential clients moving forward, yet removing another leg of Philippine growth?
Well, I think even before the COVID crisis started, the industry was already facing a lot of challenges. You have the rise of AIs. Tax incentives are also reduced under the new tax reform. The peso has relatively been, strong. It has been stable against the U.S. dollar. But if you compare it to other currencies in the region, we have actually quite appreciated. So in terms of cost of doing business, it's actually making the Philippines more expensive if you compare it to other markets. Mm-hmm. But I guess if you ask me if it will drive away the BPO, the industry, I think in terms of a talent pool, the Philippines is more attractive compared to other markets in the region. And I guess that bodes well also for India. Mm-hmm. I think what's happening right now is that BPOs are trying to upskill also their workers from a pure contact center into a more, a higher scale of, a knowledge process outsourcing. Mm-hmm. And over the past few years, BPOs have started to relocate their into other key cities such as Iloilo, Bacolod, and Davao. Moving to the property sector, I think the office segment would be probably considered a more resilient segment in terms of the property sector as a whole. I believe most tenants are still continuing to pay their rents, although there are some asking for deferral of payments. For the hotel side, it's only used for BPO employees. So I think we're looking at it also on a perspective on the property sector in terms of office segment as a total of their percent of revenues. And it seems like Mega World and Vistaland are among the big players in terms of office spaces as a percentage of their total revenue. So it may have an impact also on the sector.
encouraging news there for property plays. When you look at the bigger picture, Lex, how correlated would you say are the stock market and the real economy? Should we assume that the pace of recovery will match the rebound in the stock market?
Yes. Well, historically, if you look at the stock market, it usually prices in whatever happens will happen in the next 6 to 12 months. And that's the same reason why we value companies. So based on forward estimates, and well, the stock market basically serves as a proxy to the economy. So the market will always be ahead of the recovery versus the economy. Mm-hmm. And currently, there are no clear signs yet on when things will start to ease, when things will start to improve, given that, of course, we have cases are still rising. And so far, the market has been reacting the same way. I guess just to answer also that the question earlier, that a recession is probably has been priced in probably by the market. So mm-hmm. anything deeper than the 3.4% estimate of the government will probably depress the market further.
So I guess the question now is, are we where we are supposed to be? The PSE index today ended at 55.41. We're showing here a slide from your presentation showing that valuations bottomed out at pre-crisis level. Can you explain this slide to us?
Yes. Well, so as mentioned earlier, I do believe that the market has already priced in a recession. Mm-hmm. For now, given the current situations, we think that the bottom of the market was hit at 4,000. But what the market hasn't really priced in is how deep will the recession mm-hmm. be. So if you're looking at more than 3.5% based on what the government is saying, then of course valuations will become, the cheap can become cheaper. Mm-hmm. So we did the comparison also of the 97 crisis as well as the 08 crisis. And both bottoms of the market hit at 8 times PE, or I believe 9 times PE. And we saw the market at 4,000 at that level, our market traded as low as about 8.6 times PE. Mm-hmm. But then if the ECQ prolongs, then definitely we may have to readjust again our targets.
Mm-hmm. And we also have another slide about valuations. I think we can show that graphics, the PSEi and valuations. Okay, we're waiting for that slide. But in the meantime, and the next one, the PSEi forecast. Where do you see, you actually have scenarios here, the bear, the base, and the bull.
Yes, that's right. It's a standard for our team to provide a forecast mm-hmm. for the year. And of course, a lot of things happened in the past 2 months. So far, if you look at the current situation, current valuations, we really think that the market is still worth trading at least 12 times.
Wow. Okay.
And currently, we're about at least 10, 11 times PE. So if you put the market at least 12 times, assuming that we don't extend further the ECQ, then the market should at least trade at 6.4.
Mm-hmm. And base case based on that slide for this year is 9,200.
Yes, that was actually our forecast when during the start of the year. But mm-hmm. of course, as mentioned, a lot of things happened the past 2 months. Mm-hmm. That's why. The new item there is actually the ultra bear, which is what we're experiencing right now.
Mm-hmm. But if you look at how previous years, when the company or the country was in crisis, performed, and the year after that, we're now showing, we're actually expecting to see big spikes come next year.
Yes, that's right. The market will always recover. I think it's only a question of when. And if we compare this to the past crisis, the 97-98 Asian financial crisis, mm-hmm. the market has managed to recover, huge recover. Even the 2000 bubble, we've seen also several years of recovery. And even the 2008 financial crisis, we've also, in fact, after the 2008 financial crisis, our market recorded 11 years of a positive note. So it's just we see this as a normal cycle for the market. It's just a matter of timing and when will be the good entry for the investors. And we think that it's actually a good time, especially for the long-term investors, to start accumulating at these levels.
Okay, now very quickly, I wanted to go over with you some interesting corporate stories. We have from Ramon Ang's Eagle Cement, posting a 4.5 billion peso sales for the first quarter of this year. That's down 16%. They're saying, though, that they're expecting demand to bounce back as construction activities resume. Do you like this stock? Do you like cement stocks now?
Well, the past few months has been a challenging period for the sector as a whole. You have cheaper prices of imported cement. My view is probably the recovery will be on the second half. It depends also on how the government rolls out the infrastructure programs, and of course it's how you disseminate also the projects moving forward. So. Mm-hmm. It will really depend on how everything eventuates, on how we, act on the current situation right now.
We have this also, JG Summit's first quarter core net income falling 19% to 4.3 billion, dragged by petrochemicals and airline units. Not really surprising, right?
Yes. In fact, first quarter was already a bad figure for us. You know, it's only about 15% of our full year estimate. And second quarter will be a lot worse. It's a mixed bag. Cebu Air will definitely be a huge drag for the company. Mm-hmm. Even URC, it's a mixed bag also. Not all products are doing well. RLC obviously is also doing not quite well. So it will be quite interesting for the second quarter figures. We'll see how it goes.
And here's another interesting sector: oil. Pilipinas Shell posting 5.5 billion pesos in net losses in the first quarter of this year, and it's citing the collapse in global oil prices and slowing economic activity.
Yes, I guess we share the same view. I think two quarter will be another challenging quarter for Shell. I think the recovery will depend also on how the economy recovers. Oil is very dependent also on how the global economy performs. So if we see a recovery in 2021, so definitely it will take a time for them to recover.
Mm-hmm. And finally, Bloomberry Resorts, which is behind Solaire Casino and Resorts, posting a 38% drop in first quarter profit to 1.4 billion amid the COVID-19 pains. So I guess this is the story of resorts, casinos, hotels.
Yes, also an interesting story. First quarter was already down 38%, as you mentioned. But again, 2Q, the whole time Solaire was closed. So it will be interesting enough on how they would recover in the next few months. And if you also note that first casinos are considered as a non-essential business side. So we'll see how or when they will start to reopen. But definitely a challenging year for the casino, for the gaming industry as a whole.
Lexter, it seems like all the corporate stories I gave were challenging stories. Is there any stock in particular that you feel is going to do well despite the pandemic?
Yes, we're looking at other sectors. Banks will definitely be a bad quarter also in the second mm-hmm. quarter. But if you look at current valuations with the likes of BPI and Metrobank, Metrobank's about a 50% discount to its book value. BPI is about 10% discount to its book value. So in terms of value play, we think those are some names that can be considered. For other sectors, consumer sector, we like a few names there, such as Pure Gold. These are non-essential, non-essential items that the sector has been benefiting for these past few months. So another sector that we're looking at. And so other than that, I think it's going to be a challenging year for the market as a whole.
Okay, thank you very much, Lexter, for joining us this afternoon.
Thanks, Mimi. Stay safe.
Stay safe.